course from the center of live music in the United States, Central Texas, where there are thousands upon thousands of bands, almost always grew up in bands. Every gas station has a band, and everywhere you go there's a band in Central Texas. And of course, our ranch is not far from Willie Nelson's ranch, so I grew up listening to Willie Nelson also. He's a remarkable man, he really is, in many ways. And most people don't know what they realize about Willie Nelson. Not only is he a fantastic musician, but he's a great philanthropist. And more importantly, he does a lot of activism. He spent his entire life doing those things. And this is a man who's not even afraid to get arrested for smoking pot. He's a courageous speaker. In the 1990s, he became extremely upset that within his base of country music aficionados, there was a growing anti-immigration status amongst them that was being fueled by the political right, which was using that, of course, to scapegoat the immigrant population to blame for what was happening from an economy that they partially created. So Willie Nelson, who became fearful of this, sat down and penned this song, which I heard as a kid, and I found it incredibly moving. And they played on the rodeo. Unfortunately, it got lambasted by a lot of the people on the political right. It's just being over him in sentality, and he took a lot of hits for it, but he continued to sing it. So much that the 1994, I think, Democratic Convention, is that right? Candidate Kerry asked him to sing this song, of course, for the Democratic Convention. And of course, that was the place where Barack Obama gave that also wonderful speech. So this is called Living in the Promised Land. And Jerry wants to add something I think is also extremely appropriate.
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
One other pertinent reason, which has just come up if you're following the news, for singing this wonderful and powerful song is the fate of our brothers and sisters, public employees in the state of Wisconsin, who are fighting for the survival of collective bargaining. If they lose, look for it in your neighborhood soon. So we sing this in solidarity with them, and we hope they prevail.
Cross to bear. We are the ones to change.
promised land.
If you would be interested in joining the chorus, they rehearse on the first and third Sundays of the month at 10 a.m. in this room, and you're welcome to join me. The next rehearsal will be March 6th, next week.
Yeah.
For more information, if you choose, speak to Pat DeBrogger, our choral director, and lovely singer, lead singer. Sorry?
Jerry and I are
Jerry,
cool.
Yes, okay. Speak to Jerry, too. This morning's platform talk is by Curt Collier, one of our trio or troika of leaders here at the New York Society. Curt previously served as the leader for the Riverdale Yonkers Society for Ethical Culture and is credited with founding the Ethical Society of Austin, Texas. He is the founder of Just Matrimony, promoting marriage equality for gays and lesbians. Maybe we'll have success on that issue in New York very soon, if the governor is true to his word. Curt has served on the AEU's Assembly Committee and Leadership Training Committee, and is on the faculty of the Lay Leadership Training Summer School. He's also Deputy Director of Groundwork USA, where he heads up a very successful green team involving underprivileged young people from Yonkers in productive environmental projects. Curt is also a playwright, whose work has been produced locally, including one off-Broadway production. He is now leading an ethical economics exploration group that meets here in the Society two Sundays a month at 1:45. There will be a session this afternoon. This morning, he's going to help us understand whether or not our economy really is in dismal shape, or is it all just hyperbole? However, just remember that George Bernard Shaw is rumored to have said that if all economists were laid end to end, they would not reach a conclusion. Pyrrhic means either a war dance or a battle won at staggering cost. I'm looking forward to hearing Curt's definition of Pyrrhic economics, why political rhetoric triumphs over reason and halts real economic recovery.
And thank you for the chorus for singing that song. It still moves me. Isn't that a lovely song?
Yes.
I just thought it was such a beautiful piece when I heard it. I'm going to do the college professor thing again because that's what I used to do. And I'm going to rhyme on this. The people said they didn't like for me to use PowerPoint, so because I had to do that. So we're going to do something that's a little bit more environmentally disastrous and use paper and go with that, all right? So I'm going to take you through, and I'm going to use notes, which is rare for me. Have you ever noticed? I'm going to take us through a brief description to kind of set the scene for the discussion. I'm going to try and do this not too quickly, but obviously we have to move along. So I want you to pretend for a second that you and I are in business together. In fact, what we do is we grow roses. So here we are. Not those teacup hybrids. We're talking about heirloom roses. You know, that's what we're growing there. And in fact, in our company, of course, there's us in the big house. But we also have a bookkeeper, so she's over here. We have a master gardener, and we have three other employees who help us grow these beautiful roses. Where's the capital of roses growing in the United States?
Texas?
Tyler, Texas, very good. So, there were a lot of roses in it. So we've got three gardeners, we've got a master gardener, we've got a bookkeeper, we do this good stuff. Now, on the other side of the valley, of course, is our neighbor. And he's got exactly what we have and does exactly the same thing. So he's got a house over here. He's growing roses. He's got a bookkeeper. He's over here. And he's got a master gardener, grower, and three gardeners working on it. Lovely little scene. Now, the problem is that for both of us, the market is way down in the valley. All right? So it's way down here is the market. And unfortunately, it's a trek to get our roses, which you know have to be, you know, there's timing on these things to get them there just in time, to get them to there. So what we decide to do is we sit down with the neighbors and we have a conversation about this. And we come to an agreement. And the agreement is that what we need to do is to build a road that will make it us both easier, right in the center of our property, down to the market. There we go. Now we've got our road there, and that makes it easier for us to get there. Now, of course, to pay for this road, which is very, very expensive, we decide to do enter into an agreement. So what we do is we form a governance structure, a board, and it's several people who sit on it, and we empower them to go off and to help us build this road. Okay? That was what we asked them to do. So what they do is they go off to the bank. Bank is up here. Got little columns on it, you know, it's supposed to look imperial. They remind us of Rome somehow. And there's the bank, and they borrow $5,000, which is a fair price for a road down in Texas. And to do that then, what they do is they decide to then tax both of us to pay for this road. So I pay $100, my neighbor pays $100, $175 of that then goes off to the mortgage on the road, the payment on the road, and we hire an additional little worker they do and give him $25 a month or whatever just to look after the road. Okay, so now we have a road, we have a way to get our roses in. We have this little governance structure. We've entered into a kind of a binding agreement to make sure this happened. We borrowed money from the bank, and we go off. And business is not so bad. It cost me about 25 cents to grow my rose. I should have done this over here. I'm going to do this right here. So it cost 25 cents to produce, but I'm selling them for a dollar. So I'm making a 75 cent profit. And by the way, he's doing the same thing. Right? A dollar, he sells them at. It costs him 25 cents, and so now he's making 75 cents. And we go on for quite a long time happily like this. We've got the road, everybody's working, we're growing roses, and everything else is perfectly fine. It never stays that way. Then the letter comes in the mail from the governance structure, who we appointed in this binding agreement to kind of go there, saying that I now have to pay an additional $25. Now, the reason being is, so my taxes now go up to $125. The reason being is that my neighbor went to the governance board and argued that what we really need to do to help our economy is for him to pay less money for the bank and take the $25 and spend it in other investments. So he gets his tax bill, of course, reduced to $75. But because I have to pay the same amount of money to make it work out, I pay an additional $25 in taxes. Now, I don't like this idea. I think it's crazy. But they argued to me that it's good for economy, it's good for American business. It'll all trickle down eventually. Don't worry. Have faith that if we cut his taxes, things will work out much better for all of us. Now, I do this, of course, and I go to argue with my neighbor, but I discover that he has turned himself into a corporation. So now he's incorporated. Limited liability corporation. Now, I tell him then, well, this is crazy. You're making me pay for more money. We have this agreement. But I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to raise your taxes on the profits that you make of anything else. And he agrees. He says, okay, I will pay 35% taxes on any of the profits from my business, and that will go to that, and it'll help out. Will that be fine? Okay, so I agree to pay more taxes if, on the investments that he makes, he agrees to pay more taxes in return, and then it kind of hopefully levels up. I'm not good at math, but I go, okay, let's go with that. All right? Now, what does my neighbor do with the $25? He buys the market. Oops. Wow. It'll come up. Now, he owns the market, and because he owns the market, he decides to make some improvements on it. He puts a nice little awning on there. right? And then he decides to charge me an additional 15 cents to sell my flowers in the market. So now my price here goes up to
40.
Very good. And now I'm paying 60 cents. I mean, I'm making a profit of only 60 cents because he has made improvements. Not only that, I get a letter in the mail, once again from this lovely board out there, who's saying that because of what he's done here, he wants to improve the roads getting to the market. It'll be good for everybody. So what happens is we put infrastructure developments into this thing and more roads so that more people can come to the market and more buyers and sellers with the idea that that would be better for all of us. And of course, because all these infrastructure costs, I need to pay $25 more a month in taxes. So my taxes go up to $150, of course, to cover his taxes here, and to cover the infrastructure improvements to the market that he purchased in order so that we could make more money together collectively. And they argue that this makes very much sense. Now, I go to him and I say, yes, but my tax bill is $150 and his is only $75, but I've argued that, well, supply side economics says that if we help this guy out and he does this work, just be patient, people. The roses are going to flow out of your garden, everybody's going to want them, and everything is going to be fine. Unfortunately, because my taxes have gone up, and because my expenses have gone up, I had to let go of one of my workers. I really hate that. He's a really nice guy, but I'm forced to do that. And we continue on for a little while. Now, my neighbor then does something remarkable. He goes back to governance structure. He says, you know what? The problem with us is we're having to pay these roses. We could go to another country and have the roses made much cheaper. We could grow them there. And then if we did that, we need to reduce all tariffs and markets. By God, we need free market in this country. We can't have any of these closed-door type craziness. And he convinces them of this governance structure to lift the trade embargoes. Now, my neighbor now imports all of his flowers from Peru. He's a Peruvian. They speak Spanish so lovely. And they're gorgeous. In fact, they're overly gorgeous because of the amount of money that has been spent on the chemicals that makes these things exactly just the most perfect flowers, because they're being shipped from such a long weather and they're basically being grown in a toxic waste dump. Now, that's the first thing that happened. Now, what he does in order to do this is he fires all of his staff except for one, the bookkeeper, who's really the only person he needs in order for them to get by. So I'm still, it's still only costing me 40 cents to grow the flowers. I'm still making a 60 cent profit over here. But what he has succeeded in doing is reducing his cost now to 10 cents to buy the flowers and ship them from abroad and put them in the store. Now his profit margin has gone up to 90 cents. So mine was at 60 and his is at 90. Now, I suddenly discover that my expenses for growing my roses have gone up. How many people raise roses or raise them? They are very fickle young ladies, old ladies, and they require a lot of help, and they require a lot of nutrients and all this kind of stuff. And I go to buy these things and fresh cuttings and all this kind of stuff and discover that all of my profits have increased. I go to my suppliers and I say, wait a minute, why has everything gotten so expensive? And I discover that my neighbor has purchased all the supply companies, he's consolidated them, and then he raised the prices of all of them as well. And now because I'm purchasing just for him, that's the other problem I had. So now it costs me an additional 8 cents, now I'm up to 48 cents, to grow, where are we? And now I'm down to 52 cents, right? Boy, 52 cents to grow my profits, drop quite a bit. Unfortunately, I get another letter coming from the government structure. And they say that because their expenses have gone up so much because the oil has been consolidated and now run by one company, and their prices have skyrocketed, that I need to pay more money to be able to be able to keep that road open, right? Now, what I do then is he sends me another bill for $25, thank you, another tax bill. I get extremely angry, saying, no way, I'm not paying another bit of money on this, especially since I'm going to be firm about this, folks. That's it, no more taxes, I'm going to hold up, you're not going to pay anything else. And then they said, yes, but what do we need the road? We have to get it repaired because it's full of potholes. It starts looking like New York in February. You know, it just really goes to heck pretty quickly. And so I eventually agree to something else, okay? Now, my neighbor says, well, let's think about this for a second. Let's raise your taxes up. Of course, we'll both agree to do this kind of road, but it's not really fair for me to do that because my flowers are not using this road anymore. My flowers come by plane into JFK and are delivered almost right to the thing. So why do I have to pay for a road? Is that fair, America? Is it fair that you should have to pay for a road that you don't use? Is it fair that you should have to pay for these things that you don't use? No, sir. I think what you need to do is have a user fee. And only people who use the road can go up. So I win a minor tax battle. My taxes only go up $15. I won. You know, I said, no, I'm going to stand for no 25. They say, okay, we're only going to raise it $15. So now you're paying $165 in taxes to keep the road up. And I think the neighbor is doing the same thing, and hopefully that is true. But what happens is that extra $15 that is taken out of my taxes, of course, eventually go to my neighbor through the profits of the tax hole of the oil company he owns. So although the $15 went through this direction, it ended up going back to the oil company that he owns. And so essentially, he got a $60 tax reduction, his taxes reduced to $60. Because he doesn't have to pay anything else because he's not using the road. I'm only paying for the oil increases, but that money is going to him, right? So he's not paying any more taxes because it's a user fee only, and to be fair, this is what we need to do. Let me make sure one's over here. In fact, his agreement on that is that we should put a toll road here. This will be one way that my taxes don't have to go up. I agree. Okay, I only raise them $15. I'm only when I'm using the road. Maybe other people will hopefully use this road, and this will be tough. Now, unfortunately, my taxes have gone up another. My cost to get the flowers to the market have now gone up another 5 cents. So we were at 48 cents, right? So what's 48 and 5? 53. Very good. So I'm still selling my flowers, you know, hopefully, so what's my profit?
47.
There it is. So now, he's still making his flowers at 90 cents, you're getting 90 cents of the dollar, and I'm getting 47 cents of the dollar. Now, because my taxes went up and because my fees went up, I am forced to lay off another employee. I hate that, but I just can't afford to keep the other employee on there. So I agree to this kind of a tax structure. Now here's the problem. He laid off all of his staff, and I've laid off already two of my staff, and I'm a human being, and I hear the cries of these people who've been laid off. And so I champion, along with others, to give the laid off workers some benefits. What we say is, what if we agree to build a school where they can, a continuing education college, where they can go off and be retooled. You know, we're all supposed to, Luis, who left my farm working as a gardener, and the farmer is supposed to become a nanotechnologist now. So he just has to go to college for that. There's jobs in nanotechnology. I don't even know what they do, but so good luck, Luis. I hope it works out for you. And in addition, we agreed to pay them some unemployment benefits, right? So we agree to help out all of his employees that have lost a job and all of my employees, of course, that I've had to lay off. And so I go to the governance structure and say, let's make this work out. And we come up with a formula. And the formula is essentially that my taxes are going to go up $50. And what that allows, $250 now a month fee, that allows $25 to go into a benefit program and $25, of course, to go into the school. Now, I go to my number and I said, of course, this is based on a formula based on my profits. So what they did is we said, let's create a formula. Let's look at how much profit you make. And then based on that, we'll just split it up. It's a formula. And for me, it turned out to be $50 tax increase. You get it? So then we go to our neighbors, but they're not home. And the reason why they're not home is they moved to the Cayman Islands. It's the weather's nicer, they had asthma, you know, whatever the reason was. So now they're in the Cayman Islands. And their bank, by the way, is in Switzerland. So we ask them, well, how much money did you make on your profits? And I get an answering machine. And then I get another letter. So, of course, when we finally go to the side out, we finally figure out what they're making in this country just having a few people on staff, is their taxes go up by $5. So now they're paying $65 in taxes, and I'm paying $215 in taxes, right? Because it's based on a formula of what they're going on. Now, because so many people have lost their jobs, no one's buying roses anymore. No one can afford roses at that price. And I try to sell them at a dollar, nobody wants them. So now I can only sell my roses for 75 cents. So 75 cents minus 53 cents, I'm now making a profit of 22 cents on the roses. Right? Because this is what I can only get them for. And because of that, I had to let go of two more staff. I let go of the bookkeeper, and I start doing the books, and I let go of the other gardener. It's just me and the master gardener trying to keep this business all going there. Now, the bank then sends me a letter saying that because of bank fees have gone up, I need to pay the government supports. Because bank fees have gone up, I need to pay an additional $10 every month to cover and to keep the bank going. I think this is outrageous. Why should I now have to pay $225 for in taxes to give $10 to the bank? And I go to the bank and say, what's up with this? And I discover that the bank has been bought by whom? By my neighbor, who's living in the Cayman Islands. His bank's actually, money's actually in Switzerland, but who owns the bank. And that's the way it works out. Now, by the way, when I give my additional $10 to the bank, because he owns the bank, where does that money go? So in a way, although his tax bill was supposed to be $65, what is his tax bill now? It's $55. Because of loopholes that allow him to collect on the money. Now, I hear on the news that because so many people were laid out, a lot of people have lost their home. Right? They failed on their mortgages and all these things that start to happen. And because of that, the bank begins to fail. I am told that the bank is too big to allow to fall. Because if the bank falls, then I'm going to lose the government structure, I'm going to lose the roads, we're going to lose all the kind of monetary and money that we need to grow our economy and to help business. I am told that the additional bank bailout is going to be $150 a month. Well, we were told it would be $150 a month. So my tax bill is $75, goes up now to $75. So my tax bill is now $300 a month, right? And so, supposing my neighbor's tax is supposed to go up $75 as well, but my neighbor who owns the bank, who is also the primary shareholder, gets paid off first to make sure the bank, because he owns the investment in the bank. So sure enough, he agrees to pay the $75 in theory. I pay $75. The bank gets another $150, but he's given an additional $100 to make sure that he does not lose, that the investors, which he is the primary person, don't lose the bank, don't lose their investments. It doesn't matter what your investments are, or my investments are. We paid to make sure the bank doesn't fall, and the bank pay the shareholders off first. Now, my neighbor, who is paying far, who gets $100 from this, is now paying zero taxes in effect, argues that we have created a system in this country where the taxes are too damn high. Right? We're looking at how. And because me and others hear this and say, yes, it's 300, we vote everybody off the governance board and we vote in new people who are going to slash the budget. So what do? They decided to get rid of this school. We don't need that anymore. We decide to go off and cut the benefits of the people who are there, and we raise it for the road and things like that, we go into the disrepair. Some part of this has gone incredibly wrong, right? And this is the part that makes me so angry, because this is America in 2011. What we have allowed is this other people, which at this point is a multinational corporation, not corporations in general. We can all become incorporated. Some people think it's just corporations. It's multinational corporations. Their profits have seen record payouts. If we were to look at a graph of their profits, it would go like this from the 1950s all the way up to like this. The taxes they pay have plummeted extremely low. That 35% agreement that we originally said we were going to have, most of them don't even pay anywhere near that. In fact, the highest pay only 15% of the tax, and a lot of them don't even pay any tax at all. Because of loopholes, because of subsidies, because of all these other kinds of things. You know, the story of Pyrrhus, he was a Greek general. He was fighting against the Romans about 315 before the Common Era. And he was having this great battle, and sure enough, against the Romans, he won the battle, but a lot of his men died. So they came up to him, and they said, "Boy, here's to Pyrrhus for his victory." And he says, "Another victory like that, and I'm going to lose all of Greece." A Pyrrhic victory, hence, is to say that you've lost so much in order to get there. I argue that one more pro-business government in this country, and I don't see how we can stand it anymore as well. What has become the fact in this country is almost unconscionable. Corporations, multinational corporations, are making record profits, record, off-the-scale profits, while their tax levels have plummeted extremely low. Their argument was that this was good for business, but if you look at the GDP of this country, it's actually slowed down since the 1980s when they changed the laws to make this happen. Our growth, economic growth, has slowed by giving them more money and more tax loopholes, not increased. We are not better off. You are making the same money today as you made in the 1970s, adjusting for inflation. So while you're what you get in the bank and what you get in the checks is remaining almost exactly the same. If you're on Social Security, you know you've not even gotten anything the last 2 years, right? Everything else has skyrocketed. What's also amazing is that if I eventually decide to sell my business and give it to my youth, you know, to my children, they have to pay, of course, the inheritance tax on that. But if this person decides to leave this corporation to their youth, what happens? They pay nothing. Right? They pay the lowest tax levels. They pay almost no taxes on capital gains. They can give it to a few, not to the certain level. They pay a little bit. They do all of these things, but nowhere near the level of taxes that you're paying. And the question is how did we arrive at this mess? You know, I don't blame them. I blame us for letting them do this to us. I am angry about that because of what's happened in this country and how we allow this to happen. So they handed us a budget just recently. And if you look at the budget, they've cut everything they don't like. They've cut money to the EPA. They gutted that so that there were no longer environmental protections. They cut things like Head Start. They cut things which help workers. They've cut everything except you see anywhere in those cuts where they've raised taxes on corporations? You see anywhere on there where they raise taxes on the people who make uber amount of money with these kinds of things? Nowhere. So it's a tax cut against us, getting rid of this, because this helping these people out is socialism. We wouldn't want that, and we're only here to help others. This is not the first time this country has been this way. It used to be like that in the 1800s. There were these super wealthy men. I mean, go look at New York City, Cornelius Vanderbilt. What did he build? The railroads, right? Go to Grand Central Station. There's Cornelius Vanderbilt sitting up there. The Vanderbilt mansions. He had 15 mansions. He had one up here in Hyde Park. We only went there for a couple weeks a year. It was a hunting cottage. It's like 50 rooms. Have any of you seen it? It's gilded, gorgeous, beautiful hunting cottage for 50 people. And of course, back then, men were not supposed to stay inside the house. They spent almost all their time outside hunting anyway. My favorite is the Astors, who made money, millions upon millions of dollars. Now, I went to try to find out what they were worth at adjusted inflation. John Jacob Astor's father was worth $157 billion, adjusted for inflation, right? John Jacob Astor, the one who died on the Titanic in 1912, was worth $37 billion. Right, these guys were fabulously wealthy. John Jacob Astor Sr. made all that money selling opium to the Chinese, and of course furs, which is his other big thing. Right? John Jacob Astor had a fling. He was a married man, he was 47 years old, he had married a woman named Ava Willig, and she just wasn't doing it for him, so he had an affair. And unfortunately, Ava found out, was of course demoralized at that time of high society and begged for a divorce. The reason being is that he had fallen in love with Madeline Talmadge Force, all of, at that time 17 years of age. He was 47 years of age, of course. It created a scandal here in New York City, so they decided to flee the stares and glares of high class, and they went off to Europe for a while, and then they went off to Egypt, and unfortunately that's where she discovered she was pregnant. Now, Madeline said she wanted her children to be born in the States because she wanted her kids to be an American. So she forced John Jacob Astor, the fourth, to come back to this country, of course, so they could have their kids. And unfortunately, they boarded a ship called the Titanic. And of course, there's this great supposedly mythological story in which he took her and put her on the boat, you know. He cut his own kapok belt to show her that, oh, it's made of a different fiber than she thought it was. That was one of the stories, some ridiculous thing like that. And of course, then she put her on the boat and with her and her nursemaid, and he went down with the ship, supposedly with his right-hand man, an Indian man who worked with him, and went down the ship. She, of course, came back to New York City, and the family did not want her. What do you do with an 18-year-old dabblance of 47-year-old Astor fortune? So they give her $5 million a year at that time, in 1912, to live off of, as long as she promised never to marry, which, of course, she did. She went off and got married twice, right? However, in order to save face, what the family decided to do was to donate a lot of money to what? The New York Public Library. That's why you walk in that Astor Terrace, right? Past the Jacob Astor line, the grandfather's line on one side, and Lennox, the other man who built the thing. Or if you go into the Metropolitan Museum of Art, right? That first atrium you go to in Astor. Because if she thought she donated a lot of money, it would make it look good. I think that's not the America I want to live in. Something is desperately wrong with us, and we need to do something. I feel like I want to take a blowtorch to this whole system. And so we need to do something. We need to get our little pens out, like our man over there would be happy to do, and write people and say, no, you're not doing this, and stand up with us people as much as we possibly can. Because at the last minute, I don't want us living on the streets with nothing but a beautiful library to look at. Thank you.